to the right side.
This is...
He just drills a three right in his mug.
The Sports Hub Celtics Show.
Pops it up for Porzingis.
With Chris Casper and Jim Murray. Brought to you by Shaw's and Star Market, Bentley University, Direct Federal Credit Union, and Jack's Abbey on 98.5 The Sports Hub.
Pritchard inbounds to Mihailuk. The final seconds tick off the clock. And the most dominant season in the history of the game's most storied franchise comes to an end. The Boston Celtics cross the finish line with 64 wins and a regular season for a lifetime. The final score on the final day, Boston 132, Washington 122.
Welcome into the Sports Hub Celtics Show as we get ready for Game 1 of the NBA playoffs tomorrow. I know who the Celtics' first-round opponent is. That is going to be the Miami Heat. As the guys in green make their playoff run, Dedham Savings is here for the journey, and yours too. Go to DedhamSavings.com. Member FDIC, member DIF. All right, so it's the Jimmy Butler-less Miami Heat. And I can't help but feel, just from texts with some friends last night after that useless play-in game where the Bulls didn't even show up, I get the Heat. There's still some, I feel, Chris, and we have B-Rob as well covering the Celtics from Mass Live, and you at 617-779-0985. There's still this residual Miami Heat PTSD, which, okay, look, I get it. Don't call me Big Jim Worry for nothing, but without Butler, in the way that the Celtics have absolutely just crushed the Heat in these regular season games, and it felt like there was something extra behind these games, too, and not to mention the fact that Kristaps Porzingis felt like such an X factor for the Celtics, and he went off in these games in the regular season. They played them with an edge, I felt like. You know, that last one was close. But overall, I thought that they killed them, and they played those games like they were trying to send a message, like, no more. Mm-mm. You know, that when it's Dave Chappelle as Prince, like, looking at the camera, like, mm-mm, mm-mm. Like, that's how the Celtics played the Heat this season, and I think that's going to carry over to this first round. Like, I don't have the Heat PTSD.
I still do.
You
I
do.
Think they'll win, but it could take six or seven games.
Really?
And I'll tell you why. So I think everybody looks at that middle game where they absolutely blew them out by 30-plus in Miami, but the other two games were pretty close. The first game, 119-111 win by the Celtics, that was a three-point game with 59 seconds left to go. The last time they played him.
The last one was close.
Yeah, 110-1. And Butler did not play in that game. That was a four-point game. And with about 159 to go, it was also a two-point game. So when you look at it, I think that these games could be a little bit more grindy than if you had gotten, say, Chicago or Atlanta. And I wonder if that means the Celtics have to work more for it, which is never great for them just because we've seen in the past that sometimes they play with their food a little bit, so a series goes a game or two longer than it should, and then there's a residual effect from that as the playoffs go on, and somebody like, say, Al Horford has to play these extra games that they wouldn't have had to play, and you get into an Eastern Conference Finals or an NBA Finals, and you're maybe a little more worn down than you'd like to be. So I think they're going to win the series. But I would have preferred Chicago because I think that would have been a sweep or a gentleman's sweep. This could, even if they win this in five, I feel like it will be five grindy games.
Well, yeah, I can see, because look, you're going to get hustle from the Heat. You're going to get that Heat culture thing. They're not going to bow down just because they're without their leader in Jimmy Butler. Look, the Bam Adebayo, Kristaps Porzingis thing is going to be interesting to watch.
Yeah.
Too.
Well, first of all, based on what the Heat did against Chicago, which was they put Bam on DeMar DeRozan, and they have Nikola Jovic, who's playing. They're basically playing a double big lineup, and that kind of frees up Adebayo to use his length on a perimeter guy. So will they do that to Tatum or Brown?
Yeah. Look, here's the thing. Advantage Miami with Eric Spoelstra to me over Joe Mazzulla, because he's going to have these, you know, wacky zones. And again, he gets those guys to play. Like, so, yeah, who knows what he's got up his sleeve. They'll make it kind of a pain in the ass. Some of these games will be grindy, but it shouldn't go more than five, just because the talent gap is just too big. Am I wrong to feel this, B-Rob? Are you a little scared, too? Do you have some PTSD from prior postseasons where the Heat were the thorn in the Celtics' side?
Yeah, they're going to muck it up. And this is Bam Adebayo last night. This was his quote after the game when they beat the Bulls. It's going to be a dogfight. It's going to be a battle. It's going to be in the mud. So they know that this is the only chance they have in this series is to really just turn into slop and to win it with defense. But I think the Celtics moves that they made this past offseason, bringing in Porzingis, bringing in Drew Holiday, that takes away a lot of the Heat's tricks. because no longer is Marcus Smart sitting alone on the perimeter because they're overhelping. Now it's Porzingis or Drew Holiday there. So I'm with you, Jim. If this goes more than five games, it's a shock, or there's been a bad injury or something like that, because...
Or the Celtics played with their food again.
That's true. I mean, it's true. But
like
I
did against Atlanta.
It's fair. The track record this regular season, though, feels a lot better to me that they know this. And coming off of how game seven ended last year, guys, like they like if they come and like get bowled over tomorrow afternoon, that's just going to be totally uncharacteristic of what this team has been all year long.
So from you guys, here's what I'm hearing. I feel like you guys feel like this is going to be like a couple years ago when they faced Kyrie and Durant in the first round.
Yeah.
And they just were like, enough of you guys. You know, you beat us the year before. Jaylen Brown was out, but you beat us. Enough with you guys. We're done with you. You're not on our level anymore. We're going to smoke you.
Yeah, I think they're going to throttle this first round. Where I think it could get bumpy is if Orlando upsets Cleveland. And then I just base that off how Orlando has played the Celtics these last couple of seasons. And I know the Celtics took the last two. But there's a height issue there. Mo Wagner plays them like he's got the ass. Like, there's that whole thing. Like, I get it. Like, how many people are actually paying attention to Orlando Magic outside of, NBTV subscribers and that have the Game Pass or League Pass?
League Pass.
But I could see that being a pain in the ass series, maybe going six and being tougher than it should be, just because, again, Orlando plays the Celtics really well. There's a good nucleus there, but they're just too young.
I think they're
and
too
it's
young.
It's too early. But no, I think they should kill the Heat without Butler. And so for me, look, and I get it. Like, Celtics fans likely are happy about this because they want it as easy as possible. I don't blame you. I will say, doing this for a living, from a content standpoint, this blows that Butler isn't playing in this series.
It does. But here's the other thing, too, about Miami. And again, I think the Celtics are going to win this series. But I think that what you have to remember, yes, there's no Jimmy Butler. Yes, he's the heart and soul of their team. But they didn't have Tyler Hero in that series last year. And now they are going to have Tyler Hero. That doesn't mean they're going to win. But I'm just saying it's not like the same team you played last year that beat you in seven minus Jimmy Butler. Obviously, I think the Heat would rather have Butler than Hero. But you're still going to have Hero. And Hero traditionally plays pretty well against the Celtics. He certainly played well in this game against Chicago. He almost had a triple-double. But he plays pretty well against them. And he also helps mitigate one of the biggest issues I feel like Miami has against the Celtics a lot of times in these playoff series, which is putting the ball in the basket. The guy's not a very good defender, but the Heat have a lot of guys, the Caleb Martins of the world, who can grit and grind and muck it up. Where they struggle is to put the ball in the basket. Tyler Hero can do that.
Yeah, if he goes back, if we see 2020 Tyler Hero in the bubble when he was just running circles around that team, then this series could get a little bit interesting. But the problem is, Terry Rozier for this series, he's like day to day with a neck situation.
A neck injury.
He hasn't played for a couple weeks.
Since April 7th.
Exactly. So when you take him out of the equation, you take Jimmy Butler out of the equation. If Bam, unless Bam's going to decide to say, I'm going to score 30 points a night right now, so much pressure is on Hero to create and do it all for that team. And based on how he's done all year long and based on the defenders that the Celtics have now to throw at him and Drew Holiday and Derek White, I think that's just going to be too much of a burden for him to overcome.
But we said that last year, and then what did Caleb Martin do in the series?
If Caleb Martin wants to shoot 50% again from three,
not even be Caleb Martin is my point. And my point is maybe this year's Caleb Martin is Jaime Jaquez.
It's true.
Maybe this year's, Caleb Martin ends up being Nikola Jovic. I'm just saying we've done this before where they have no firepower. There's no way. It's not going to happen. And then some guy that you've never heard of or there's some developmental guy Haywood Highsmith.
That's the guy this year. That's the guy to keep an eye on.
Haywood, is it? You think it's the guy?
Legitimately, that's the guy to keep an eye on.
Yeah.
Now, why? Because you know more about basketball than we do. Why do you say that guy?
He's had good games against the Celtics all year long. If you look at the back of these games, he's the guy who's going to hit the corner threes. He defensively, he'll stay on the floor because he's got good versatility there. And so, if you're Caleb Martin's going to start, but Hayward, Highsmith's going to be the guy off the bench that's filling that Caleb Martin role in this new team.
Cautious finger wagging from my co-host.
Yeah, I'm a little scared. I would prefer not to play.
Did you want Philly over the Heat, Gasper?
Yes, because Embiid's not healthy.
Wow.
Embiid's not healthy.
Yeah, I didn't want. I thought Philly was going to be a bigger issue.
Tobias Harris is not what he used to be. I really want to say choke artist. Not what he used to be. And I don't know. And Philly's fans are just hostile about their own team. They're so mad. And I feel like Nick Nurse, Spoelstra is kind of a wash from a coaching standpoint. I don't know. I don't think this is great for the Celtics. Not because they're going to lose this series, because they're going to expend way more energy than I want them to expend in the first round when I'm looking at, I almost said they. Boy, I almost thought I was on NBC Sports Boston for a second. I almost said we, talking about the Celtics. They need to go all the way and win this thing, and I want them to do that. And I'm like, I don't want to expend any extra energy against the Heat in the first round.
Well, we'll get some of that we perspective from
wow.
Chris Forsberg of NBC Sports Boston. Get his thoughts on this upcoming series between the Celtics and Miami Heat, which again tips off tomorrow afternoon at 1 p.m. at TD Garden. He's going to be joining us next here on the Sports Hub Celtics Show.
We'll have more of the Sports Hub Celtics Show next.
BackstageCountry.com, your online home for all things country music. Picking five of Carrie Underwood's best music videos was no easy task, but after some debate, we landed on five we believe rise to the top. Did Carrie's 2014 hit Something in the Water make our top five? Find out when you text Carrie to 45911 and scroll through the list on BackstageCountry.com. Text Carrie to 45911 to get your eyes on our favorite Carrie Underwood music videos.
Listening to the 98.5 The Sports Hub Celtics Show.
I've won us all over, and best of luck in the playoffs, and we'll talk soon.
I appreciate it. Hey, last thing I want you guys to know, I came into coaching because I think NBA players get a bad rep, and you always hear about college coaches or people say they can't coach. I got the best group of guys. I think NBA players in general are misunderstood with what they deal with on and off the floor, like what they put their bodies through, and like, just because they make a lot of money doesn't mean that it's easy. And so I got the best job in the world coaching the Celtics, and I got the best job in the world because I got great players, and they allow me to be myself and allow me to coach them. And, you know, I can't take that for granted. So I want you guys to know that.
Celtics head coach Joe Mazzulla with Big Cat and PFT on PMT, pardon my take, on Barstool this week. Came off good in that. I always think
he comes off... Yeah, that was very cool that he did that. That's one of my favorite things that Joe Mazzulla has ever done. That was really cool.
I think he comes off really well with the interview he does weekly with Zoe and Beadle, too, and it's like...
Yeah, he's great at that.
You know, so I just wonder sometimes, is the uptight thing that we've dealt with over the, you know, since he's taken over as head coach, like, is it kind of an act? Is it a defense mechanism? It's something.
I mean, I think he's really into defending his players, so I do think there is an element of, I'm trying to think of the right way to put it. You know, I do think there is a little intransigence. You know, if he comes to the conclusion from a basketball standpoint on his own that something needs to change, I think that's one thing. But I think when it's coming externally, just reflexively, he pushes back against it.
All right, joining us here in the Sports Hub Celtics Show is get ready for Game 1 in this first-round playoff series between the Celtics and Heat. NBC Sports' Chris Forsberg joining us here in the Volkswagen Dealers Expert Hotline. I don't know if you heard the first segment to open the show today, Forsberg, but seems like the man to my left, Chris Gasper, a little as scared of the Heat even
without Jimmy
Butler.
Don't want to expend this energy. I don't want to waste this much energy in a first-round series.
Oh, wow. I'm fretting as this Gasper. Did you watch this game last night?
I did. I saw some of it. Yes, yes, I did.
I mean, I don't know. I just can't get myself worked up about it. And if you're the Celtics and you feel you're as good as you displayed for the course of 82 games, I get the assertion that it's not the ideal first-round matchup. But I don't know if there's any team in the East that should really – I hate to sound, like, super overconfident in this team, because that's usually when it starts to backfire with this group. But I don't know. I just – watching the totality of the season, watching when they're engaged, like, they're just on a different level than most teams in the East. And I don't think you can go into this. I think back to 2022 when the whole we're not a track team, we're not running from anybody, like, that's when brought out the best in this team. And I would be very, very surprised if they don't show that they are a better team than this Miami squad.
Oh, yeah, don't get it twisted. I'm not saying Miami's going to win the series. I'm saying I don't want to have to expend this much energy and go 6 or 7. So how long do you think this series is going to go?
5.
Okay.
Gentlemen sweep. You know, there's always the potential. I think the one thing that does give me a little bit of pause is we know how good Spoelstra is, and he's going to junk up the game at times, and certainly you're going to have to be able to react to that in the moment. I think the addition of Porzingis makes the team so much better in terms of when that zone defense is out there, finding ways to break it, you know, kind of keeping teams away from doing that because of how impactful he can be. Now, look, the Celtics lost their minds in various games this year, so can I tell you that they're not going to do that in those moments? Like, I can't say for certain, but I just feel a lot more confident in that. Now, the one thing that also has to go right is, like, You know, last year you probably had, and Brad Stevens likes to term it, the two worst weeks of basketball that you played all season. And maybe the Heat had their two best, and, you know, Martin going nuts. And, like, there's all these variables that go into it. But just in a vacuum with the way, like, just how good this starting five was with the health woes of Jimmy Butler, you know, it just feels like it's really set up here for the Celtics. If they come out with the right focus and mindset and play to their abilities, this shouldn't be a long series.
Do you think in any way that maybe this benefits the Celtics getting the Heat so early? Maybe it makes them sort of more battle-tested, battle-hardened for the whole way? Because my concern, like I said again, Forsby, is sort of the totality of it. You know, I expect the Celtics to be playing in June. I expect them to be playing in the finals. And I've just watched past postseason runs where they sort of waste games, don't put teams away, end up having to expend more energy than they should, and then it kind of comes back to bite them in an Eastern Conference Finals series or in an NBA Finals series. But you could look at it the other way and say getting a team like Miami that's not going to roll over right away, you know, might help them sort of get in that groove faster than they normally would.
Yeah, and that's why I keep going back to 2022. Like, was getting the Nets in round one ideal? No. Yeah. Like, but there was something to the idea of having to go through KD and Kyrie, given all that had gone on with that. And it felt like it really kind of sparked them a little bit. Now, it got muddy from there, and obviously going deep against the next two rounds obviously taxed them and left them short in the finals. But I think this team's deeper than that one. I think they're just more dynamic this year. And again, like every time I'm going to throw the caveat of they've got to show it on the biggest stage. But I really do believe in what this team has this year. And look, you guys know how much I liked Marcus and Rob. And it was at first even stomaching some of those moves was like, I don't know. But really from the jump of the season, you could see like how Holiday and Porzingis just made them different, was going to make them just the, like a little bit more dynamic in the moments that matter most. And so like Porzingis got to show he can do it on the postseason. I think he's only got like 7 playoff games to his credit, 2 first round losses in Dallas. But like Drew's been there 70 playoff games, won a championship. Like I feel really confident in this group, and yet like the playoffs get wild.
Yeah, so that being said, and it's Chris Forsberg, NBC Sports Boston, to Gasper's point about the Celtics losing focus, and in other words, themselves being the only thing that could get in the way of them winning a championship, is it actually a good thing that the East is riddled with injuries? Like, again, no Butler here in this first-round series. Embiid's banged up for Philadelphia. Giannis Antetokounmpo, who the hell knows what's going on with him? It feels like that's that Durant Achilles waiting to pop.
No Julius Randle for the Knicks?
Yeah, right. So yeah. I get that fans look at this and be like, it's all set up for them, but do you worry about them losing focus because of the way the East, again, is just riddled with these injuries to the superstars?
Yeah, and I think that's Joe Mazzulla's challenge is to sort of make sure they stay focused. That, you know, there was that one game at the end of the regular season where they treated it like a closeout game, even though they had already secured everything. And I think that was a pretty hefty focus the last couple of weeks where it's been like, you know, too often this team can't get out of its own way. And, you know, so certainly while there's the ability to sort of downshift mentally and they've got it, they can't just show up and think like this is going to be easy. I will say talking to these guys this week, the general sentiment has been, you know, they're more locked in. They understand it's back to 0-0, all the cliches. So I feel like they're ready for that moment. But yeah, like you can't sit there and say, okay, like the path is right there. We only have to worry about getting to Denver. You have to kind of go through the grind. And I do go back to the whole thing that Gasper says. I think one thing that would worry me is if all of a sudden, you know, no matter how it shakes out, if you're going to 6 games, 7 games, if Tatum's playing 43 minutes a game, that all sort of adds up. You'd rather the West have to beat each other up because of how daunting it is out there, and that you hope someone like a Denver limps into the playoffs. Celtics just have got to understand it, none of this is promised, and rarely does it break in your favor the way it seems to have, and they need to maximize every moment of it.
I know the nucleus has changed, and if they're saying all the right things, and it feels like this is going to be their year. Do you have any concerns, though, about the way that they have played at home and that carrying over in the postseason? Like, again, like them losing all those home games last year, it's like, what the hell's happening here? Do you think that there's any... Do you have any concerns about that in this, you know?
I mean, it's infuriating. Like, yeah. No doubt. It's so funny. I think like one of the, you know, maybe 10, 20 games into the season, we were at a practice and, you know, I just asked Joe, I said, was there an emphasis on being better at home? Obviously they started whatever the ridiculous number was, 21 games in a row before that Denver loss.
Yeah.
And, you know, they sort of stressed that it wasn't, but I mean, you can't tell me you look back at postseason runs of previous seasons and don't kind of kick yourself. Like you can't see Miami on the other side tomorrow and be like, oh yeah, you know, just because we're at home, it's a win. Because the last memory you should have 327 days ago is them beating you and walking off on your own court. Like, at some point, you got to get sick of watching the Warriors celebrate on your home court, watching Miami celebrate. Like, that's got to matter. And you don't work as hard as you do during the regular season to not take advantage of that. So I just keep going back to it. Like, I hope they've learned lessons. You keep hearing Joe talk about, like, there's different paths for everybody, and that's absolutely true. But, you know, this team has to recognize that it has complicated its own life by not taking care of home court advantage, not salting away series quicker. You know, can they show that they've actually learned from that? Will having someone like Drew, who's been through it, like, remind them of these things? So they just got to show that they've learned.
I want to bring up this stat and see what you think about it. The Celtics in games where the margin of victory is 10 points or more this year, they're 42-5, and they set the NBA record this year for most wins by 25 points or more in a single season with 17. Yet, in games decided by 3 points or more this year, they are 6-7, which is not horrible. It's middle of the pack. Frankly, the Denver Nuggets are only 6-6. The Minnesota Timberwolves are only 7-6. But my point is, you know, every artist has their preferred palette. The Celtics' preferred palette is the blowout. Do you have any concerns in the playoffs about close games?
Yeah, absolutely. Like, it's the one thing that probably, and I've written it a lot, is that it's the one area, clutch time, that kind of gnaws at me. You know, it's so funny because they finished, I think it was 18-12 in clutch games. So any game that was within 5 points, final 5 minutes. And it was fourth best in the NBA. They had the fourth best net rating in those minutes. Like, everything says they're a good clutch team. And yet you start, like, playing with the numbers, and okay, what about in one possession game's final 3 minutes? It goes down to like 14-12. You do it any game they were trailing by three or tied in the final 3 minutes, and I think it goes down to like 8-12. So, like, one thing that we found out in 22 is that regular season clutch success does not give an omen of what happened in the postseason. Like, the Celtics were terrible. They were the second worst clutch record in the NBA that year. A lot of weird things, COVID, all that. But they were better in the postseason, played 12 clutch games. I think they won 7 of them. So, like, it can swing both ways. They can either be really good this, and I, like, overreacted to those during the regular season. But I do think that's the one area they've still got a little something to prove. Like, when things get tight, will they react the right way? They haven't always responded well to adversity. They have more weapons to counteract it this year. They should be better in those moments. Tatum's numbers have been far better in the postseason at like those game tying go ahead shots than they have been in the regular season. But I do think they need to show that they can run different sets. They just won't run the usual Tatum fadeaway. Like, go back to the play out of the backcourt that worked like 1,000 times in a row when Joe Mazzulla first got here, and show that you can do, like, take advantage of all the weapons that you now have instead of just settling for, you know, what a lot of teams do in that situation. And if they do that, I think they'll be successful. But again, it's a little bit of show me. And that's probably the one area between health and late game. That's the only thing that, like, over the totality of the postseason, it will be areas that I'm concerned about.
And this is just a comment, not a question, Forsby, but that's what makes me a little nervous about Miami, is just because I think they have more of a chance of putting you into a close game. Again, you know, everybody focuses on the blowout that the Celtics had in Miami, but the other two games were pretty close. The last one they played against them, they had a 15-point lead, but it got cut to 2 with 1:49 to go. The first one back in October was a 2-point game with 59 seconds to go. To the Celtics' credit, they won both of those games. But I think these games have a greater likelihood of being close. That's why I feel the way I feel, and I'm a little scared. That's not a question, just a comment.
And you're absolutely right to feel that way. I mean, familiarity typically breeds closer games, more intense series. Like, there's something to the idea of a rivalry. Like, I think I would feel that way more if Jimmy Butler was healthy, because he's particularly in those moments the one that scares me.
Yeah.
But I, like, fair or not, I look at that roster and like, the players can't say this, I can say it. Like, I look at that, I'm thinking, who's making the last shot for this team?
Whoever this year's Gabe, like, Vincent is. I don't know. They'll find some guy we've never heard of that will do it. I don't know. Somebody will make it.
All right. Yeah, the rookie, like, just coming off the bench. I don't know. Like, I will steal myself for the possibility of this getting maddening.
Some Division III college basketball player Pat Riley found will make the shot.
He's shook, Forsberg. He really is. It's surprising to me. So, look, I know you... I know you didn't get to the shoot around, but you hearing of hear anything about any extra bells and whistles the team is planning for the Garden crowd tomorrow to kick off the playoffs? A Wahlberg singing a national anthem, maybe a Red Panda, a Red Panda halftime.
Oh, I hope it's Red Panda though. That would be big.
Well, I mean, listen. We should have we should just make it a residency for Red Panda.
I
like, make
this
the sphere of Massachusetts and just have her here. I haven't heard anything. I do know some of the legends are in town today.
Yeah,
they're
right.
doing an appearance. So Larry Bird, Kevin McHale, they're on town, and it is unique that the Celtics pushed their practice a little bit later. So I don't know if that gives us any hints about what maybe happened today, or maybe some speeches or anything. I don't know if they can make that happen, or if Larry Bird would even want to drop by and give that speech. But I do think the Celtics go all out with these sort of things, and we'll make sure the players and fans are properly motivated. The only thing I'm fretting is that Mike Gorman doesn't get game one, and so at least we got games 2 through 6 on our air. So hopefully, as much as I want as many games as possible for Gorman, I hope the Celtics take care of business pretty quickly, and Gorman gets his proper send off.
Nobody, you said it better. You know, Mike's the best. He is Celtics basketball for me. But I just want to say, you mentioned the games that are on your air. Are you guys have all your Wii's ready to go?
Yeah. We played well. We were great tonight.
Yeah, we were great tonight. We didn't get it done. We killed the Heat.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Am I allowed to? Am I allowed to do that anymore? I try to police myself, but sometimes you let the Wii go out there when you're around.
It's the playoffs now, baby. You got to get if you want to glom onto the green and use the royal Wii, you got to do it now. This is the championship season. If you were doing it during the regular season against some regular season game against Memphis, no, now's the time. You got to unholster those Wiis. Let it go. Let it ride.
Well, I mean, now you've emboldened me, and that could end bad. I'll have my green pom-poms waving by tomorrow afternoon.
Thanks, Forsberg. Chris Forsberg, NBC Sports Boston, Celtics reporter for NBC Sports Boston. Always great stuff. Thanks for taking the time.
Thanks, Forsby.
Thanks, y'all.
Take care. He had to go to the shootout, as did the shoot-around. As our own B-Rob, too. So he's going to be leaving us shortly. But I will say, so with some of the legends in town for this opening of the Dick's Sporting Good.
Yeah.
What, in a perfect world, game one tomorrow. It's just Bird, McHale, others all gathered, and they look at the bench and say, "Don't you disappoint us." Like that. And
University of Miami thing, yeah. Where the guys used to do it. They tell them, be like, you're not just representing yourself. You're representing us.
Couple open lines. You want to join us, talk about this series tipping off tomorrow. Celtics, Heat. Gasper's a little scared. I think it's crazy. But your thoughts on it, 617-779-0985.
Stay tuned for more of the Sports Hub Celtics Show.
BackstageCountry.com, your online home for all things country music. Like most of us, Keith Urban also has a bucket list. You may be surprised to learn what is and is not on his. Text Keith to 45911 to read and learn more about the central theme of Keith's bucket list. Get a link to the story sent right to your phone when you text Keith to 45911. Go inside country music at BackstageCountry.com.
The Sports Hub Celtics Show with Gasper and Murray on the Sports Hub.
Hello, boys. I'm back. And this year, everyone's gunning for you.
More baseless attacks inbound.
Only, just gotta stay in front. Keep those hands active, boys.
What do we do? Chances of me shooting them down are a generous 40%.
That's the thing about the Celtics. They play down to your level.
Bravo! Get out here!
Happy him to be here.
Aw, can't hurt us. It's just magic.
No! Don't let your guard down!
That's a portion of the Celtics being portrayed in Bleacher Report's newest Hero X-Ball episode. Chris sent this to me on the old gram. It's really well done. It's very much like the Celtics coming together like Voltron. And there's some snarky lines in there like you hear, we play down to the competition.
Or there's one where they fall down and basically Derek White is completely disabled. And they're like, Jalen, you're going to have to drive with your left hand.
Yeah.
And he goes over to Derek White's, portion of the robot. And he's like, this is the opposite of how I have my preferences. And then they just show a ball roll out of the robot's hand. It's really well done. Someone sent it to me on Instagram, and it's like, I didn't know about this series. It's kind of viewer into Game of Zones. It's like the same thing. Yeah. I actually on Max went back and watched like the first season of it, and but it's really cool. But it's satire, but it really speaks to a lot of truth. Like in Tatum's basically robot, he has this Mamba snake.
Like little charm.
Yeah, little charm that's basically like a devil on his shoulder, and it says stuff like dominate, force everything. Yeah. Like, you know, and he's like, no, we're a team. So it's really cool.
Yeah, NBA social media, NBA Twitter, stuff like this. I like the snark. As a fan of snark, there's always, you know, a lot of good tongue in cheek stuff in there. So you can search that on Instagram. Again, that was the Celtics Bleacher Report.
But it speaks a little bit like any good satire, it speaks a little bit of truth in there in the part that we played, where it's the idea of, hey, everybody in the East is gunning for the Celtics. And, you know, he says Paolo Banchero, so, you know, get out here, Paolo. And he's kind of like a Harry Potter type. And it's the idea of like, oh, you know, the Magic can't hurt us. And that's really the only thing that can hurt the Celtics is if they let their guard down and are overconfident at this point. And that's kind of the knock on the Celtics, is that the Celtics' biggest opponent in the playoffs, it's not the other team. It's them. It's getting in their own heads and making sure they can get out of their own way.
Dean and Shrewsbury up here on the Sports Up Celtics show. Dean, go ahead.
When the Miami Heat, they muck it up, they mean one thing, and that means fouling without getting called for the fouls. They try to foul as often as possible, and they know the refs won't call them all. This can lead to injuries, and this is why I don't want to play Miami in the first round. I'm scared of them, not because of extending the series or because I think we can lose to them, but because I think their play leads to injuries, like they injured Giannis, Randall, and Tatum last year in the playoffs, and I don't like that we're facing them. This is the old Pat Riley's on the Knicks strategy.
It's a great point by Dean, and Pat Riley in the 90s, when he almost ruined basketball single-handedly, the idea was foul every time. They won't call them all. They can't call them all. And there is something to that with Miami and their level of physicality. I think that for the Celtics, it will be interesting to see how they handle the toughness of this series. It's going to be a physically tough series, but also a mentally tough series. And I can't believe we're 46 minutes into the Sports Hub Celtics show talking about the Heat and the Celtics in a playoff series, and you haven't brought up what I think is always the most succinct and accurate assessment of why Miami doesn't fear the Celtics that you always talk about every time. Oh, how do they look at the Celtics?
Bitches. Yeah, but I feel like, again, the Celtics played with an edge in those regular season games, and without Butler, who I think is the main guy that looks at him as like, yeah, these guys, these clowns. He ain't there, and I know, look, he can get in those guys' ears from the bench or what have you, but it's just not the same. So I think the dynamic's just different. I know. Believe me, if he was there, I'd be with you. This is probably going to go seven. I wouldn't be been shocked if there was an upset.
But you do know he missed a lot of games this year. And also the last game they played against Miami, the one that was a 2-minute, the one where they almost blew the 15-point lead, he didn't play that game.
Yeah, I don't know.
And he played the same way. So, I mean, don't get me wrong. They're way better with Butler. It's not even close. But I just don't think their mentality, and you saw that a little bit against Chicago, they didn't have Butler. Did you feel like they played differently or their mentality changed?
No, the mentality didn't change.
No. So they're still going to muck it up and make it a mess. But Dean's right. I worry about the injury thing. I worry about the Celtics having to expand. Again, let me be as clear as I can be. I don't think Miami's going to win this. I just worry about
them
taking a chunk out of the Celtics that costs the Celtics down the road.
All right, we will go through your calls the rest of the way. One more segment to go of the Sports Hub Celtics show. Your thoughts. Again, there's some concerns for old Chris Gasper as the Celtics are going to get the Miami Heat as the Heat crushed the Chicago Bulls in the last play-in game out of the East last night. So it's Celtics Heat game one tomorrow, tipping off at 1 p.m. Your thoughts, 617-779-0985.
You're listening to the 98.5 The Sports Hub Celtics Show.
BackstageCountry.com, your online home for all things country music. Picking five of Carrie Underwood's best music videos was no easy task. But after some debate, we landed on five we believe rise to the top. Did Carrie's 2014 hit Something in the Water make our top five? Find out when you text Carrie to 45911 and scroll through the list on BackstageCountry.com. Text Carrie to 45911 to get your eyes on our favorite Carrie Underwood music videos.
And Celtics play here.
Tatum for a 50 piece.
This is the Sports. Sports Hub Celtics Show on the Sports Hub.
As we get ready to wrap up the Sports Hub Celtics Show for this week and say goodbye to B-Rob, who has to go cover the Celtics shoot-around, you know, cover the Celtics for Mass Live. Let me just ask you guys this quickly before we move on, B-Rob. We'll start with you. Is there an ideal, let's say they get out of the East. I think it's a massive disappointment the Celtics don't get out of the East. Like, it's epic disappointment, like all-time horrible. But we assume they go to the finals. Is there a finals matchup you're hoping for? Even selfishly for travel.
So Denver, I think for basketball purposes, Denver would be the best in my mind. Like the chess match that would go on in that series between figuring out how to stop Jokic and Murray would be something else. Travel wise, my wife went to school in Minnesota, so I wouldn't mind going to Minnesota for her.
Okay.
And I think that'd be a fun playoff series out there too. Anthony Edwards, Gobert, like we'll see if they get out. They might not even get out of the first round against the Suns here, given what they got going on there. But I'd get. Underdog would be a nice little scrappy Minnesota Celtics. I'd like that.
Chris?
You know what I'm going to say.
Well, L.A., of course.
Yeah. Kawhi, yeah. Kawhi, get healthy soon. Good luck to LeBron and the Lakers against the Nuggets. So, yeah, L.A. would be the one for me from a selfish perspective because I have family there. I would agree with B-Rob. I'll throw a different one out there just because everybody says Denver. I would agree with them. I think Phoenix would be a fun series. I think Celtics-Phoenix, I know those games during the regular season weren't great, but Bradley Beal's playing a little bit better. Booker's been to a finals. Kevin Durant and the respect between Durant and Tatum. And you would have sort of, you know, Booker and Tatum each trying to get their first ring. And two really high-level offensive teams. I think that could be fun.
Yeah, and as I said yesterday, though, it would end up being the softest NBA Finals ever. Like, who's just going to be a little less soft?
But you know who would be there? You know who would be checking out that NBA Finals?
Name a Kardashian.
I was going to say Kendall Jenner would be there. All her guys would be there.
I mean, that's any NBA Finals, really. So, yeah, selfishly, look, if it was L.A., that'd be amazing. I don't see, you know, who wouldn't want Celtics-Lakers? I don't see the Lakers putting up that much of a fight to Denver. I think it's crazy, some of this talk from some of the national talking heads. I think it was Skip Bayless saying yesterday, like, it's Lakers in six. Are you crazy? No one really has an answer for Jokic. And Anthony Davis in that front court, like, beat up. Like, get out of my face. Now, if they were able to... If D'Angelo Russell, like, caught fire, you know, they're hitting threes. Okay, you might get a competitive series, but that's not going to happen. So, yeah, from the basketball standpoint and overall, I'm hoping for Celtics and Nuggets, B-Rub. The one I don't want, say they send us. You never know. You know, there's belt tightening. Radio's a fickle business. It'd be great basketball, but if it's Celtics, OKC, great matchup. Travel? Oh, God. Like, good luck to anyone on that one.
Yeah, you've been there. How is that place? How is that city?
It's a worse San Antonio. They have a Riverwalk, some cheesy businesses. It's where Sonic, the fast food place, is based. They're real proud of that.
And, isn't like Hertz based there, or one of the rental car agencies centered there, I think?
Perhaps. That would make sense. So, yes, it's a worse San Antonio. Now, you would maybe ask, well, how do you feel about San Antonio, Jim? Horrible place. So, yes, it's a worse San Antonio.
I was underwhelmed by San Antonio when I covered the Final Four there. I mean, I will say I did have some really good food, but I just thought the downtown would be a little bigger and there'd be more to do. And also that river kind of smells.
Oh, yeah, sure does. So, again, you're getting all that, but worse in OKC. Those mid-market hellholes
like,
where you got to take two planes to get to, like, that's
bad.
Awful.
For me, like, San Antonio, I would be, when I, San Antonio, I'd be like, it's Austin adjacent, which is, like, you know, it's just this big thing. I want to ask you guys both this, because I know B-Rob has to go, and we're going to wrap up the Sports Hub Celtics show, but we're having this discussion off the air. Do you think it's better or worse for the Celtics to have to immediately confront last year's playoff failure in the visage of the Miami Heat? Would it be better if they got like a round in and, you know, sort of got some confidence? Or is it better that right off the bat they have to confront last year?
The only thing I have a little concern about, and maybe they would, you know, well, I wish they would have ended up with a Hawks or Bulls or some real loser team so they could tune themselves up, is because they haven't played a meaningful game in like a month. So they might see, you might see some rust early, but overall, no. Like, you need to slay the demon early. Like, the team that upended you last year that really had no business doing so. And it kind of made you look foolish. And I know they're without Jimmy Butler, but no, it's, I think it's better for Tatum and Brown to face the demon early.
100% better. You flick it right in the eye right away. Yeah. You can't fall into a lapse like out of the gate here because you're looking at the team that dethroned you last year. And even if Jimmy Butler isn't out there, there's a lot of guys on this team that played out of their minds against the Celtics. So no question, that's it. And we'll see. We'll see. You know, you might get the sleepy series in round two against Cleveland and Orlando. But all these teams, really, whether it's Miami, Cleveland, Orlando in round two, they're all really good on defense. So they're going to test the offense a lot on that front. And that's been the Celtics' Achilles heel in their postseason runs in the past. The offense falls apart when it matters most. And so they're going to have to be ready to go right away in that front.
Well, that's a great point by you on the defensive nature of those teams. You know, I'm really just facilitating with that question.
Isn't it?
Yeah, it is fun. Yeah, facilitation is fun. Yeah. Now I see why people like doing it. But I do think that if they are able to get through these guys, you know, in four or five games, it will be a huge confidence boost. So I even though I'm a little scared and I don't love this matchup, I do think that if the Celtics are able to do what you think they're going to do and what you think they're going to do, B-Rob, and what Chris Forsberg thinks they're going to do, which is wipe the floor with these guys in four or five games, I think that would be a huge confidence booster for the rest of the playoffs.
Chuck in Brighton with a thought on Joe Mazzulla. Hey, Chuck.
Hey, guys. You know, I've spent a lot of this last year thinking that, you know, one of the two reasons we wouldn't make it all the way is because Jalen is our number two or Mazzulla being our coach. And before the playoffs start, I just want to definitively state that I'm way more worried about the latter. It feels like he never takes accountability, and we may have the best record in the league, and the East is a joke, but to me, it's hard to imagine getting past Denver or anybody who comes out of the West. If we lose coaching and thus mental fortitude will be the reason. And that clip you guys played earlier, it feels much more like sucking up to the players and the organization to keep his job safe more than anything else. You know, we took our foot off the gas at the end of the season, and it's hard to imagine that happening under Ime. And I remember after Ime was fired, the talking heads were saying the things like he would never coach in the league again, but that's not the case. It only took 1 year for him to sign with the Rockets, so I can't help but be frustrated that we haven't gotten a definitive story from management why he was fired. So, you know, to finish it off, though, I wish Ime kept it in his pants, allegedly. Until we get the whole story, I think that management will deserve significant scrutiny if we lose because of Mazzulla unable to lead our team and hold them accountable. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, Chuck. All right, we will actually do the headlines here because we're up against them. We'll get right back to your Celtics calls just to wrap up here. So we'll get to more of your calls. You have thoughts on the series tipping off tomorrow, Celtics, Miami Heat. Join us, 617-779-0985, as the NBA playoffs are going to be tipping off right now, too, with Orlando and Cleveland. But headlines here and then the final hour, Gaspar Murray next.
BackstageCountry.com, your online home for all things country music. Like most fans of country music, we're excited to learn that Luke Combs was back in the studio working on his next album. We've come up with our list of iconic Luke Combs music videos. Yes, Lovin' On You made the cut. Text Luke to 45911 to see if your favorite made the list on BackstageCountry.com. Text Luke to 45911 and we'll send the link straight to your phone.